you're stymied, right? I mean, how do you create? How do you produce? How do you solve things additively faced with that prospect? So these are some of the ways people are working in and among negotiating that reality. You have adaptive reuse and repair of products. There's a swathe of repair and fix-it manifestos and workshops and just general, you know, movement around this notion, which is exciting. There's the notion of emotionally durable products, and this dates back quite a while, but the idea that, well, one solution would be to make design so beautiful and lovable that you won't throw it away, you'll just keep it forever, right? That's one approach. there's also advocacy for the custodial use of things and places rather than ownership. That's why we're seeing so many kind of sharing tool libraries and things like that. There are certain things you don't actually need to own, right? So you can rent them or borrow them or whatever as needed. The design of processes, situations, and systems rather than material objects. The chair seems to be the subject of these sort of designers' particular venom. You get a lot of anti-chair manifestos going on. The use of just-in-time and small-batch production methods. This is really actually becoming commercially viable. And this is the sort of area that I don't know enough about yet, but I think is really, really interesting, which is the use of digital technology to visualize the impact of the Anthropocene. Okay, so this is a fairly old project now, but by MIT Media Lab, which attempts to track the global migration of trash. So by placing sensors in a select items of trash, you can then track its movement over the world. How far it travels before it reaches its final sedimentation in the strata. Whether that's a plastic container of liquid soap traveling across country here or a brown coffee cup. And then another, or the last of this little group of approaches that I'm noting to how to be a designer in the middle of this of this kind of ecological crisis is this increasing numbers of things that seem to be pre-programmed to dematerialize, deactivate, disassemble, or decompose. And this is one of my favorite examples of that by an Icelandic student designer called Ari Johnson, who's designed, I mean, the water bottle, I mean, this is the classic design problem of our time. And so you'll see many of these. You've got edible water bottles and so forth made out of agar. This one's made out of seaweed, and it holds its shape while the water's still in it, but once you've drunk it, it slowly starts to decompose. It's quite neat. I'm not sure what it tastes like, though. So, time to wrap up. So today, therefore, just like Dickens, Dust Mound, Denizens, and the many design critics that have followed, and you can kind of categorize them as Victorian design reformists, you had the post-war taste anaesthetists, the environmentalists, some of whom we've met, and the drop city commune dwellers, the urban beachcombers, the American pickers, and the yelpers. It is we, the public ourselves, who must be the sifters, and not just of the design products, of course, but also what Brian Thill calls our endlessly accumulated tab flab, the constantly updating, linking, tagging, and streaming piles of our daily digital detritus, which is just as much an issue, I think, as the physical manifestations of waste, certainly in terms of time, maybe not so much space. For if design criticism did die one morning in June 1970 in the Colorado Mountains, and now everyone is a critic, then it is we, as curators, archivists, designers, editors, readers, and voters, who have the responsibility to sift our own trash, based not just on excellence and aesthetics, but also taking into account new and more urgent measurements, things like repairability, deep geological time instead of convenience time, and political toxicity. We must be critical of the algorithms that seek to determine our preferences on our screens, but also well beyond them in our streets, schools, studios, museums, and meetings. It's important that we continue to make, identify, and use the kinds of design criticism with the potential to enrich the ways we think about design, to diagnose symptoms of harmful and wasteful practice, conduct informed salvage missions, and then illuminate paths to recovery. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you very much. I have a lot of questions, but one of the things is that at the beginning, I studied sociology in the 70s, and when I saw your images, it reminded me very much on what was happening in the University of Amsterdam, and not only in design, I think, but in all other fields also. Do you think that, you're staying now 2 years in the Netherlands.
Yeah.
You think that the design community in the Netherlands has enough awareness of what is happening in all the things you're talking about in schools or in practice?
Okay. Of course you do. No. we've been having this discussion quite a lot, and with Niels, actually, who's sitting right there from the Royal Academy of Art in The Hague. And one of the things I think is really important to a design education is to be surrounded by all of these different discourses and not to be isolated over in a corner with the designers in a sort of constant feedback loop of cool design, right? And so I do think that the university model that is in play in the States, I never thought I would be bigging up the States and in terms of its education, but I am. But the way that it's that design is taught in some situations there, right in the middle of the university, alongside philosophy and geography and English literature and all the other disciplines, I think is pretty beneficial. What's arguable is the actual output good? Is the design that is produced there of the same quality and level as it is if you isolate it in an academy? And that's, I think, where the debate kind of continues. But certainly I think the thinking is improved and the sort of the possibility of moving design beyond being purely making to something more of a liberal art or a sort of a branch of the humanities, I think that becomes possible. All that to say that at the Royal Academy of Art in The Hague, I've just joined their ranks, and I'm setting up a new design lectorate there. And one of its main missions, not just because of me, but this is something they've been working on for a number of years, is to make a big connection to Leiden University and all of the discourses that go on there. And the idea is there will be an exchange between the two. So, yeah, that's tangentially response to your question.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Are there some other questions you want to ask to Alice? Yeah.
I wanted to ask a question about the formats of the student countercultural interventions in the conference.
Mm.
Looking at them now, they seem frighteningly similar to kind of the formats which are mostly encouraged today, even by the institutions which are most kind of entrenched in the design world, like I don't know, MoMA, PS1, or even things like that happen in Salone del Mobile in Milan or mm-hmm. in Dutch Design Week. So I was wondering do you think that through a format, whether it's a new one or a reaction to this one, there's a possibility for a new critique, or do you think that in general that space for discussion has just been totally subsumed into the design culture, not in a radical way or an antagonistic way, but just as the kind of normal modus operandi.
Yeah. Well, the capitalist system has an incredible ability to absorb its critiques, right? I mean, that's basically, I think, what we see being played out is that pretty much everything gets co-opted. So to the point where, you know, these things that were pretty radical at the time get commercialized. But whether there's the possibility for critique now, I do think so. But like I say, I think it's in a state of real flux, because that notion of there being a central conversation, you know, there was a time, many of us remember, where we could have turned to a design magazine and you know, we would have all been reading the same articles. And you remember turning to the letters page in Emigre? I don't know if anyone remembers that. But that was a thing, that was a scene, that was a vibrant discourse that people felt connected to. And there's no point bemoaning that, or you know, that's long, long gone. There is no central conversation. So it's going to be totally fragmented. And that's why I was kind of saying it's sort of up to us, each of us, to be super critical and to sift out our own strands, from what's around. I don't know. It's now that I repeat it back like that, that sounds a bit individualistic. But I do think there's a possibility of reclaiming a shared conversation, Tamar. I don't know. I have to believe there's still the potential for critique that means something. It's just we don't know yet what the formats are, because everything's in chaos at the moment. But often out of chaos comes exciting stuff. I'm just kind of waiting for what that will be. And I suppose I think what I was saying is that I'm keeping tabs on the kind of design work that is about, that's sort of starting to happen, that engages, like that digital trash tracking thing, where the commentary is encapsulated in the design itself. So I think that possibly is where we're gonna see it, but it needs to get a bit feistier first. Yeah.
Yes, my name is Michiel Schwartz. Where to start? You've got so much you unearthed. But I do have, I think, a fundamental problem with the way you position design and design criticism, which is reinforced by going back to 1970, where maybe at that time it's easy. You have design, you have different forms of criticism. You can say you can have design, society, environment, and say, where does this come in? But if you fast forward, which you do, to today, isn't it the case that all that has become interdependent? I mean, design is not as separate as it was in 1970 from society, however defined. I mean, just if you think of the coming up of social design, just to mention one word, or design thinking, all kinds of design has become much more integrated in society. And also, when you talk about things that have to do with sustainability, it's as much social sustainability as an environmental one. It's not that design, as if that's one box, has to relate to another box, which is called the environmental impact and trash, and then a political one, which is social political responsibility of designers. So by putting so much emphasis on the 1970, I think we have to, my question to you is, isn't design itself and the debate on what design is and what we want it to be in relation to those things the fundamental question, rather than saying, well, this is design, this is what designers do, and now we're going to critique and think about what that box, how that relates to the other two boxes?
That's a really good question. I certainly don't try and say what design is, but I definitely do put things in boxes. Busted on that one. And that's a kind of analytical crutch, I suppose, so that we all fall. But no, I'm in absolute agreement. I'm coming much more and more to the place where it became into focus when I got this new design lectorate that I mentioned. like, do we actually even need that word? You know, like, because the kind of stuff I want to look at, the social, for example, I think this term or this kind of area of practice called environmental humanities encapsulates my interest a lot better than the word design does right now. But, you know, I think you still have to keep it there to sharpen. There is something still particular about design, right? I mean, it does lose its focus when you start to consider it, as you say, in its interconnected systems. But there is something particular, and I still believe in that. I haven't worked it all out exactly why, but for the meantime, I still want to use design as my lens for examining these social issues. So that's where I am. As for the emphasis on the 1970s, yeah, I take your point. It was a little skewed in this presentation. In the book, in my study of design history, the history of design criticism, I start around the 1950s, and it does shift and change, but this is more dramatic, this stuff. So.
Okay, thank you. I think one of the nice things that the Wim Crowell Institute is connected to the University of Amsterdam is, for instance, that we have a fellowship with Frederik Huijgen and connecting other students than design students to what's happening in the design world. I think it's very important that not only designers think about design, but also people like you from the outside are looking to the world of us. And
well, I mean, yeah, your collections are a really good example of that. I mean, they are collected for their graphic excellence in many cases, but some of them are collected because of their social significance and their political significance and their the extent to which they represent periods of history and moments in industry, you know, like Tete Rode and whatever. And then they're right next to the Egyptian collections and everything else. So I love the way that that's all positioned together here.
Okay, I'm afraid we have to stop now.
That's fine.
Thank you very much for your very inspiring lecture.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
And I want to invite you all to go now to the bijzondere collecties, to the restaurant over there, to have a drink and to talk more about the subject of this afternoon. There's one thing different than last year's. You have to pay it yourself, the drinks, this year. But that's all. For the rest, it's all the same. Thank you very much.